saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, saying with a loud voice.
Good morning, everyone. I'd like us to reverently kneel and sit for a moment. Thank you this morning for your blessings. We thank you for giving us another opportunity to continue to study from your word, the various lessons that you prepared for us this day. Now we come to look at the issue of country living in light of education, reform through education, and the plan that you had for us. I pray that, Lord, you may speak to us this morning. I ask that you may forgive me my sins, that, Lord, you may use me as a vessel to pass on the message that you have for your people. I pray that you may touch each and every one of us today, that we may make haste on that which you have called us, to save the time that is remaining and be able to avail ourselves to you, to be used for your service in closing the work before the time of probation ends. I pray that you speak to us this day, for we pray in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Did you have a good night's rest?
Yes.
All right. I had a nice rest too. Two questions that were passed on yesterday. I just quickly like to go through them, and then we can continue with where we left yesterday. The first question is a question on true education as Seventh-day Adventists, Christians. We should let the Bible be our instructor in the law of faith. The subject of true education, are there any training for the children who are dropped in high school, or is only concentrating on the little ones? What courses can they do? Okay. So the question is whether there is any training for those who have dropped in high school. I'm not quite sure what they meant by dropped in high school. I was hoping that we are not only going to train those who did not pass in high school. I'm hoping that we are not giving God the residue, so that those who pass in high school can continue with the admission to the Babylonian University. I hope we are not giving God change. You know, there's this habit of coming to church and giving offering change. You know, the money that you don't need. I hope we are not doing that with our decision on education. Because God has not asked us to give him the residue. We read the book yesterday, Ecclesiastes chapter 12. That what should the young people do? Remember now thy Creator. Alright? While you are still young. And so God wants the best. God wants the best brains. And so is there any training for young people on true education? Like I said yesterday, we have all been painted with Babylonian thinking. And people think that by choosing true education, you are also going to get a certificate and get a job. Because that is how we think. We are thinking, we've been brought up to think that life is going to a school, getting marks and getting a certificate, and getting a CV and to get a job. And so if you can't get it in the secular, you might get it in the true. God doesn't work like that. That is not true education. You must put aside all that. It is as high as the heavens are from the earth. That is how different it is. You must change the thinking. And so this thing of thinking that there is some training for true education, and so you will go into that training thinking, like, as you look at the other guys, how they are training and you are training and hoping that you will meet. I say true education, I accept country living is not an alternative lifestyle. The same thing, true education is not an alternative system of education. It's not a choice that you make as the remnant. It is the plan of life that God has for you. So it's not something you can choose between that and lead and say, okay, you can't compare apples and oranges. And so it's important that we put aside our Babylonian thinking and understand that true education is a journey for both young and old. Especially the old. When was Abraham called by God? I was actually going to read for you that verse, but now that this question has come, let me just ask, when was he called? Was he a youth?
No.
No. So don't think that it's only for babies or for youth. It is for everyone. Everybody who's in this room, you need to get on with true education. And if you understand what it is, what is true education? Missionary training. Many of us think we are missionaries. We are not. I am not a missionary yet. I'm still in the school of being prepared to be a missionary. And so let us not think that there is a certain college somewhere where I will get true education. If it is, they used to be. I was speaking with somebody the other day on the history of Adventist education. We had started on the right course. This church, God has favored it, and we shall be severely judged for the opportunities that God had given us. We started with the truth on education reform, and we picked it up where Martin Luther and his colleagues had left it, and schools were established with grounds for teaching the students on farming and on how to evangelize. We used to have schools like College of Medical Evangelists. Anybody heard of that school? College of Medical Evangelists. What comes to your mind when you hear that, the name of such a school? College of Medical Evangelists. Do we have a medical evangelist here today? Anybody who is doing medicine here? Who is doing medicine? Zadok, you are very selective in inviting the people who are coming to this camp. There are many times I've spoken to groups and they are medical students. You sure there's none here right now? Okay, don't be shy. You're here. Anyone who is in medical school? Okay, there's one at the back there. Don't fear. So, when you hear a college of medical evangelists, a medical evangelist, that means that they were training medical students to go as evangelists. So they were taught how to treat and care for the sick, and they were also taught how to evangelize. And so when they graduated from the school, they were missionaries, but they were medical missionaries. They were nurses and doctors. And they were taught how to farm. They were taught how to grow their own food. Now, we used to have such schools, but there was a lot of opposition. From 1906, 1907, there was a lot of opposition. And guess from where? From church leaders who had gone through the education system that you guys have gone through. The Greek education. They had graduated, some of them were doctors and professors, and yet they were beginning these schools that were true education schools.
And so they began to oppose the messages of Sister White on education reform. They began to incline to wish to conform with the schools of the world. And if you really read Ellen G. White's messages on trying to combat that tendency, they are very clear. Even 1909, 1910, she was trying to resist the tendency to conform to the world education. Unfortunately, when she was laid to rest in 1915, it did not take 7 years, and College of Medical Evangelists was changed completely, and it was called Loma Linda University. You guys know Loma Linda University?
Yes.
It was changed in 1922. And so it had fully received the charter as a regular secular university, offering the courses that the world offers. From an institution that was supported and that was built from the foundations of people like before Kellogg had apostatized, the people that were respected from the secular people knew that we were years ahead in terms of treating disease. But unfortunately, the desire to conform got the better of us. And so that is why today you don't find such a place where you can go for training as a missionary. I don't believe that it exists in this country where you can get that kind of, not even the legal provision for it. Okay? And so Loma Linda was lost in 1922. I think Andrews University had been lost much earlier. So the apostasy continued until 1928. It had gone all the way to the secondary schools. Because remember, the universities received their students from the secondary schools. So they set the standard for the requirements for entrance to university. And so the schools, the secondary schools also had to conform to the secular curriculum. 1928 was the time when we finished, we lost all our schools. And so we don't have an Adventist institution today that teaches true education. Not with the regular lines. You guys understand what's the regular lines?
Yes.
The conferences, the unions. It doesn't exist. It ceased to exist long before any of us were born. Right. And so I would like to tell you that we don't have those. Just like when Christ came, there was no regular school that he could go for training. He did have that. If I had time, we would have gone through the education of Jesus Christ. I'll just mention it briefly today. But when he came, he also found that there was apostasy in the schools of the day. As a matter of fact, the Pharisees had made an alliance with Alexandria in Egypt. They had made an alliance, and some of their teachers had gone to learn Greek education. And so they had the Greek philosophies of Plato and Socrates combined with their theology. And so their thinking was completely corrupted. But Christ could not go into such a place. And so today we don't have an official center like the schools of the prophets where you could go and just get prepared. And so we have to look at the methods of Jesus Christ and the methods of John the Baptist and the likes and the methods of Abraham on how God used alternative means to prepare his people for the work that we have ahead. I hope I've answered your question. And so this does not just apply to youth, it applies to everyone. Everyone that is here, you are called to be a missionary. We need to get ourselves ready, and let's look at how did Christ do it, and he left us an example where everyone can follow. The second question, I see you asking what courses can they do? You can get the Babylonian thinking, all right? I don't blame you, I understand, but I just want us to know that I will mention what are some of the areas that we need to prepare. in terms of just I wasn't here for to cover comprehensively the true education courses. I believe somebody else, I think the lady who's presenting in the afternoon, will cover that. But I will just mention briefly in my presentations, especially tomorrow, when we're getting the practicals of the country living on some of the courses that you will be learning in true education. They are very different from what we offer in the world. The second question is it okay to employ workers in our country homes, gardens, to help with work in this time, or should we go about only alone? I'd like us to look at the book of Exodus chapter 20. Just to look at from verse 8, it says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shall thou labor and do all thy work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou, nor thy son, nor thy daughter, nor thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates. On the fourth commandment, God expects that we shall have servants, isn't it?
Yes.
But you must keep the Sabbath. So, yes. If you keep the Sabbath, I just gave the parable of the workers, the man who had a farm, and he went to the marketplace and found some people who were idle and said, hey guys, why don't you come and work in my farm, I'll pay you. Right? And some came in the morning, others came at 10, at noon, and at 5, and he paid them the same. And use that lesson to illustrate that you cannot do some of the things alone, especially during the time of planting or harvesting, you need help. So God expects that we shall have workers. But as you hire these workers, they need to learn the God that you believe in, right?
Amen.
On Friday, you need to release them at lunchtime so that they also go to prepare for supper, okay? And still pay them a full day, all right? Don't pay them half day. It's not their problem, all right? Yes. You have to pay them a full day on Friday and release them at lunchtime. Okay? And that is how they know that you have faith in the God that you believe. Okay? They are ready to work until 5, but your God requires you that you need to prepare, isn't it?
Yes.
Yes, on Friday you release them at lunchtime, pay them the full day. And don't say that because Friday is half day, don't come on Friday. No, that's not fair. Alright? I have workers and I have had to learn the hard way. We need to practice what we preach. And so on Friday, by 1 o'clock, I tell them, go. You have to go. I pay them, and they go. That is what we are taught to do. Right? Even those who are paid are paid. So that I tell them, go and prepare for the Sabbath. I know they don't keep the Sabbath, but I'm asking them to go because of Sabbath. Right? So it's okay to have workers on Sabbath. I mean, not one in your garden. Just make sure that it's a way that you can use to evangelize to them. So they can get knowledge. I want us to look at, I know yesterday we did some, today will be my last presentation on making the foundation for country living. I really am trying to stress this because it's extremely important that we understand it right. There are many people who have jumped into this message, ran to the countryside, and then after a few months, they have gone back to the city. Because they didn't understand what they were getting into, right? Count the cost to be a missionary. It's not easy, you know? It is a sacrifice. That's why Jesus says, take up your cross and what? And follow me, right? If you want a good life, you want to be comfortable in this life and enjoy yourself, please don't get into this thing. Just stay where you are and maybe see the best you can get out of it. This is a work for the called out, those that are willing to walk the way Jesus walked. Let's look at the book of Genesis. Genesis chapter 12. Genesis chapter 12, verse 1 and verse 4. Now the Lord had said unto Abraham, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred, and from thy father's house, and to a land that I will show thee. When you look at that statement, it is kind of explaining what had happened earlier. Earlier we have been given the generations of people after the scattering from the Kutawa battle, and we have been told how long they lived, all the way up to Terah and Abraham's son, that's Genesis chapter 11, verse 31, and how they moved out of their home and to the land of Canaan. And then, in verse 12, we are explained why they moved out. And the Lord had said unto Abraham, get thee out of the country and from the kindred and from thy father's house, and to a land that I will show thee. And I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse him that curseth thee. And in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed. Now verse 4 says, so Abraham departed as the Lord had spoken to him, and Lot went with him. And Abraham was 75 years old when he departed out of Haran. And so for me, my emphasis here is verse 4. So Abraham departed as the Lord had spoken unto him. And like Moses, Abraham did not question, so how am I going to survive? What am I going to do with my family? Where am I going? He didn't ask those questions, because God didn't tell him exactly where. He says, come out of your people and go into a land that I will show you. He left by faith. And it is because of that that he was counted righteous. When we trust God fully, even when we have many questions that we would like to answer, but we just move because God has said it, then we can be counted as Abraham's descendants. Oftentimes we've been brought up in a system of asking questions and questioning things that we don't understand. Because it's the Babylonian system, you know, you have to start from doubt. You are taught to doubt everything until you can prove it. That is where we have things called theses, hypotheses, theories. Because you have to question something and test it and do papers and theories and defend them. And so you are given a degree. We are taught to doubt. But the true education is by faith. We trust that God has said it and he will do it. And so I just thought that we need to change our mind to be that of a child, for we shall not see the kingdom of heaven. We need to trust God as a child trusts his parents. God has said it, then let us believe that he will do it. Now yesterday we saw this statement. The more nearly we come into harmony with God's original plan, the more favorable will be our position to secure health of body, mind, and soul. An expensive dwelling, elaborate furnishing, display, luxury, and ease do not furnish the conditions essential to a happy, useful life. Do you believe that? It seems to negate all that you've been brought up to think. Living in leafy suburbs, driving in nice cars, and having an expensive mansion is equal to happiness. But here they say it's not. And indeed it's not. You talk to some of those people who live in those places. There is no hope. It's not there. Let us look at the life of Jesus. Jesus Christ. This is a brief summary. I would have liked to present a whole session on Jesus Christ as an example of education. But let's just, this slide will have sufficient information that we could start. Jesus came to this earth to accomplish the greatest work ever accomplished among men. He came as God's ambassador to show us how to live so as to secure life's best results. What were the conditions chosen by the infinite Father for his Son? The first condition is what? A secluded home where? In the Galilee. The second condition? A household sustained by a job in the city? As a honest, self-respecting labor. So there is some labor that is not self-respecting. There's some labor that, what is the opposite of self-respect? There's a labor that makes you inferior. There's a labor that asks you to work on Sabbath. There's a labor that goes against what you know as the truth. If you're working, for example, for a company that makes harmful substances, and you heard Wycliffe talking about maintaining good health, you are constantly having guilt that you are doing something that is harming other people. And often such labors pay very well. But you are harming other people, isn't it? Yes, that is not self-respecting labor. A labor that makes you feel unhappy with yourself because you know it is wrong, but you are there for the money. Hello? Yes. Are we together? Yes, there's some labor that you know is not good. You shouldn't be there. But you're stuck. A life of simplicity. Life in the cities is very complex. It's not a simple life. You have so many issues. You have to maintain appearances. Okay? You must appear to be doing well. Isn't it? Yeah, many people fake it, you know? They must be in a good office location. You must be in a suit every day. You must appear to be very, very successful. And so they go into great lengths to maintain the status quo. They don't live a simple life. A life of simplicity. Number four, daily conflict with difficulty and hardship. No soldier is ever trained in the barracks. Isn't it? Yes. They are not trained in the barracks. They are trained in the hardship. The human mind, you can only train them with hardship and toil and difficulties. That is what builds character. Without difficulty, even athletes. No athlete became a star by sleeping and just relaxing and having a good time. No. They have to deny themselves, they have to work, they have to wake up at 4. They have to deny many things to be able to maintain that stamina that can win a crown that perishes. Self-sacrifice, economy, patient, gladsome service. Not patient, complaining service. Murmuring service. No. And so those qualities had to be, those are the things that you need to learn. Somebody was asking which courses to take. These are the courses to take. This is the course. Really. You have to learn how to sustain yourself with honest, self-respecting labor. That is course number one. Let me tell you, the reason why if you ask many of our pastors today, they are in a dilemma. They know the truth. Many of them know the truth. but they are under instruction from their bosses to do what they are to teach, that which their bosses want them to teach. And the reason why they have no choice is because they depend on what? They have a salary. He who pays the piper calls the tune. You guys don't know that phrase? Yes. If I pay you, you have to say what I want you to say. And so the most successful medical missionary is one who is self-sustaining. You support yourself. Self-supporting missionaries. Those are the ones who are most successful. Because then you can speak the truth without fear or fail. But when you must be paid a salary by somebody, then you must subscribe to that person's views and doctrines, or else you are going to lose your job. And so we need to pray for our pastors. Because unfortunately the system they have been taken through places them on a platform where they have no freedom of conscience. And so these other courses, self-sacrifice, economy, you know, patience, gladsome service, those are the courses that we need to attend. And those are the courses that Jesus Christ had to take in the secluded hills of Galilee. The hour of study at mother's side with the open scroll of scripture, the quiet of dawn or twilight, in the green valley, the holy ministries of nature, the study of creation and providence, and the soul's communion with God. These were the conditions and opportunities of the early life of Jesus Christ. You know, I've been to the farm where I stay, and you know, you look up in the night sky and you can see the stars, you can see Orion, you can see the moon. I came to learn some deceptions that I've been taught in school about the moon. I never learned them either, I never went to the country. There are so many false things you are taught in the name of physics and science in secular schools, but you can never know them unless you go to the countryside to study nature for yourself and see with your eyes and know that the things that are in the Bible are true and not the things that are in the textbooks by the heathen. Because when you study those things in the textbooks by the heathen that are written primarily to counter the Bible, you will grow up to disregard and disdain the scriptures. But when you are out there and you study providence and nature, you will come to discover that every word in the Bible is true. There is not one family in 100 who will be improved physically, mentally, or spiritually by residing in the city. And I know many of you raised your hands that you live in the city. I'm asking, what are you still doing there? There is not one family in 100 who will be improved physically. Wycliffe was talking about health. Physically, mentally. Many of you think that being in the city, you will improve your mental capabilities. You are being misled. You are being fed poison and erroneous knowledge. Knowledge that is commercially oriented. Knowledge that cannot prepare you to be a missionary. The knowledge in the city will not help you to be a missionary. It will help you to work there and do the economy of the city. But it will not help you in the work that God has set you for you to do. Give unto Caesar that which belongs to Caesar. Why are we holding on Caesar's things? Give them to Caesar. If it is a secular education, leave it to Caesar. That belongs to Caesar. It is designed to work for the secular system. And it is perfect. The Greek perfected the education system. And when the Jesuits decided that they needed something to combat the true education, they borrowed the Greek system and they placed it there, and it did a perfect job. So leave it to them. We are different. Faith, hope, love, happiness can far better be gained where? In retired places. Is this area a retired place? Who comes from this area? Anyone? Around here? Yes. Is this a retired place?
No.
No. A place where you can have peace of mind and you are far from neighbors and you can speak to your God without interruption and learn from nature, away from the hustle and bustles. Those are retired places. Where there are fields and hills and trees, take your children away from the sights and sounds of the city, away from the rattle and din of streetcars and teams, and their minds will become more healthy. It will be found easier to bring to their hearts the truth of the Word of God. Those who will take their families into the country, place them where they have fewer temptations. The children who are with parents that love and fear God are in every way much better situated to learn of the great teacher, who is the source and fountain of wisdom. They have a much more favorable opportunity to gain a fitness for the kingdom of heaven. Send the children to schools located in the city, where every face of temptation is waiting to attract and demoralize them. And the work of character building is what? Is what? No, the people in this group, there is always a problem. They are not talking. And the work of character building is what? Yes. For both parent and children. Because character does not only affect the children, it affects the parent. As a matter of fact, it affects the parents much more than the children. I don't know what else to say. I don't know how else I can put this. You are in great danger by residing in the city. You are in great danger as older people by residing in the city. You can't even see what has been going around us by those who dwell in the city. You can't see the embarrassing events that have been taking place in our churches in the city. By respecting people, it is because we dwell in the city. We do things like the way the city people do them. When temptations and trials come, you will be flawed because you've not been trained. It is not safe to stay in the city, even if you call yourself, what we call ourselves? We are reformers, or who are we? Huh? We call ourselves the remnant. How can you be the remnant and you are still not there, if you are not left Babylon? The remnant are those that left Babylon. Isn't it? Yes. Nehemiah, Ezra, they did not stay, sir. They did not stay in Babylon. They left and they went back to Jerusalem. As we are still in Babylon, the king has given the decree that we leave and we don't want to leave. There are many Israelites that were in Babylon at the time that the king Artaxerxes gave that directive that you guys go back. And they did leave. They had lands, they had got married, they had settled down. They didn't want to go back. Only a handful left to go and build the temple. Few realize the importance of shunning so far as possible all associations and friendly to religious life. In choosing their surroundings, few make their spiritual prosperity the first consideration. parents flock with their families to the cities because they fancy it easier to obtain a livelihood there than in the country. The children, having nothing to do when not in school, obtain a street education from evil associates. They acquire habits of vice and dissipation. The parents see all this, but it will require a sacrifice to correct their error. And they stay where they are until Satan gains full control of the children. Lord stayed in Sodom until the last day. And he lost everything. Everything. And so if we continue to stay in Babylon and in Sodom, we shall lose everything. And we may not be so lucky to be plucked like a brand out of the fire like Lot. We might also be lost. Better sacrifice any and every worldly consideration than to imperil the precious souls committed to your care. There will be a sale by temptation, and she can talk to me. But it is your duty to do what? Read for us. Can you read that?
Yes.
Okay. Every influence, every habit, every tie that keeps you from the most free and open and hearted committal of yourselves and your family to God as missionaries. We'll just change this also because we have a single verse in red. So, instead of the crowded city, seek some retired situation where your children will be so far as possible shielded from temptation. And there, train, let's read there, and there,
train.
You guys don't speak like, I know you're struggling with this issue, but you don't speak with convincing, with conviction, especially this side. I think there are a lot of parents this side. I'm sorry, but unfortunately, this is the word of God. This is from Testimonies, Volume 5, page 232, 233. You can go, how many believe the prophet? Well, she said, I'm just reading what, I read this thing, I said, what am I doing in the city? And I had to leave. I left a lot of things. I was fine. I didn't have to leave. But when I read this, I had to leave. Nobody had told me before. I was brought up in a pastor's house. My dad was a pastor. I'd never heard of this. I came to learn of this, not probably about 6-7 years ago. Where have I been all this time? I was asking myself. But if this is what God has said, we have to do it. If you believe God, you have to believe everything God says. I want us to speak with conviction. Let's read that statement. And there,
shame and repent them for usefulness.
That is where we are going to train and educate them for usefulness. In a retired place. I don't know which are the retired. There are many. You have to pray, God will show you. We're going to discuss more about where. But we need to understand and believe that we need to get out of where we are. If we are going to be fitted to be missionaries. And you know, there is no more church left. Brothers and sisters, there is no more church left to do God's work except you. You know that the regular line is finished. It's done. The message that the pastor gave us last evening, you will never hear it from any church today. I don't know if you understand what I'm talking about.
Yes.
The topic that the pastor was discussing last evening, you can never hear it from any Seventh-day Adventist church. And I can tell the conference leaders, anytime. It is not allowed. That is taboo subject. Not in any camp meetings that they have organized. You are the only people that are going to carry this message. And you are still holding on to Babylon. We have to get out and be prepared because the church has closed its doors. The sin of Sodom and Gomorrah. What was the cause? Ezekiel addressed that cause. Pride, usefulness of bread, fullness of bread, and an abundance of idleness was in her. This is Ezekiel 16, right? Let's look at Ezekiel 16. You know, if you do not take the call of God to do his work, he will find other people to do it. That you shall be called to account. The church has closed its doors to the message of present truth. You have that message, but you don't want to be trained. God will find other people. But maybe you have been called at such a time as this to do this work. Verse 49. Behold, this was the iniquity of the sister Sodom. Pride, fullness of bread, and an abundance of idleness was in her and in her daughters. Neither did she strengthen the hand of the poor and the needy. Those are the three ingredients found in the city. Pride, fullness of bread, and what? An abundance of idleness. All who would escape the doom of Sodom must shun the course that brought God's judgments upon that wicked city. We must shun from that course of ease and comfort and pride and fullness of bread. And secular education teaches you pride, religious. It is taught from kindergarten. It is taught by giving you marks and grades and congratulating you for being number one or getting an A. It teaches you to observe your birthdays. Somebody asked me the question on birthdays. I just mentioned it yesterday briefly. Birthdays are pagan, brothers and sisters. They are pagan. There are only two mentions of birthdays in the Bible. The first one is found in Genesis chapter 41, verse 18. There were those two prisoners that were together with Joseph who had a dream while they were in jail, and they came to Joseph to interpret and say, Joseph answered and said, this is the interpretation thereof. The three baskets are 3 days, yet within 3 days shall Pharaoh lift up thy head from off thee and shall hang thee on a tree, and the bird shall eat thy flesh from off thee. And it came to pass the third day, it was Pharaoh's birthday, that he made a feast unto all his servants, and lifted up the head of the chief butler and of the chief baker among his servants. And he restored the chief butler to his butlership again, and gave the cup into Pharaoh's hand. But he hung the chief baker as Joseph had interpreted to them. This is the first mention of a birthday. Who was having the birthday?
Pharaoh.
Was Pharaoh of God's, one of God's people?
No.
He was a heathen. It was the heathen that celebrated their baptism, not Israelites. There is no single Israelite mentioned in the Bible that celebrated a baptism. In fact, Job said that cursed be the day I was what? It is better the end of something than its beginning, Solomon said. Nowhere did Jesus celebrate his baptism. The second mention is with Herod. And on Herod's birthday, John the Baptist was hanged. In each of the birthdays, someone died. And today we want to join the heathen in celebrating our birthday. It is self-idolatry. Somebody brings you gifts and congratulates you as if you did anything to bring yourself alive for us. We are stealing the glory that belongs to who? We are thieves. Every time you celebrate a birthday, you are a thief. Because you are stealing God's glory to put it to yourself. I'm sorry to hurt your feelings, but that is the truth. It's a pagan thing. It's not meant to be amongst the people of God. An abundance of idleness, pride, and fullness of bread. Those are the things that we should avoid. And so, we find the secular system trains our children pride, and birthdays are held, especially in the lower classes, the kindergarten. Anyone who takes their children to kindergarten on birthday, don't they celebrate their birthday? Yes, my children used to go, and every time it was the birthday of my daughter or my son, my wife has to look for a cake and take it to the school, and the classroom, the classes stop so that they can sing for the child. It was a ceremony, a serious religious service in honor of the boy or girl. And kids grow up proud and selfish, and they're just small gods. It is a terrible injury to our children to make them honor them back. There is no worse crime you can do than that. And to erase that takes time. It's heathen. Just like Easter is heathen. Easter was the day of the god of fertility, Ishtar. Don't you see people having eggs? What have got eggs got to do with the day Jesus was crucified? But they are eggs when the day Jesus was crucified. So what are eggs got to do with Easter? Eggs, an egg is the symbol of what? It's a symbol of fertility. The god of fertility, Ishtar. And so the Roman Catholic Church, when they were trying to sanitize the pagan holidays, they baptized it to be the day of crucifixion, so that we could also join the pagan rites.